There was an appalling silence between the three of them, the two who spoke and the shadow that listened behind them. "Before answering that," said Raoul at last, speaking very slowly, "I should like to know with what feeling he inspires you, since you do not hate him."
"With horror," she said. "That is the terrible thing about it. He fills me with horror, and I do not hate him. How can I hate him, Raoul? Think of Eric at my feet, in the house on the lake underground. He accuses himself, he curses himself, he implores my forgiveness, he confesses his cheat. He loves me. He lays at my feet an immense and tragic love. He has carried me off for love. He has imprisoned me with him underground for love. But he respects me. He crawls, he moans, he weeps. And when I stood up, Raoul, and told him that I could only despise him if he did not then and there give me my liberty, he offered it. He offered to show me the mysterious road. Only he rose too, and I was made to remember that though he was not an angel, nor a ghost, nor a genius, he remained the voice, for he sang. And I listened and stayed. That night we did not exchange another word. He sang me to sleep. When I woke up, I was alone, lying on a sofa in a simply furnished little bedroom with an ordinary mahogany bedstead, lit by a lamp standing on the marble top of an old Louis Philippe chest of drawers. I soon discovered that I was a prisoner and that the only outlet from my room led to a very comfortable bathroom. On returning to the bedroom, I saw on the chest of drawers a note in red ink, which said, "My dear Christine, you need have no concern as to your fate. You have no better nor more respectful friend in the world than myself. You are alone at present in this home which is yours. I am going out shopping to fetch you all the things that you can need." I felt sure that I had fallen into the hands of a madman. I ran round my little apartment, looking for a way of escape which I could not find. I upbraided myself for my absurd superstition which had caused me to fall into the trap. I felt inclined to laugh and to cry at the same time. This was the state of mind in which Eric found me. After giving three taps on the wall, he walked in quietly through a door which I had not noticed and which he left open. He had his arms full of boxes and parcels and arranged them on the bed in a leisurely fashion, while I overwhelmed him with abuse and called upon him to take off his mask if it covered the face of an honest man. He replied serenely, "You shall never see Eric's face." And he reproached me with not having finished dressing at that time of day. He was good enough to tell me that it was 2 o'clock in the afternoon. He said he would give me half an hour, and while he spoke, wound up my watch and set it for me, after which he asked me to come to the dining room, where a nice lunch was waiting for us.